everybody. Thanks for joining me in the music room today. Another episode of Fat City Spin Out on tap for you today. Records either new to the collection or that I've been listening to recently. Before we get started though, I just want to give a quick thank you and a special shout out to Brother Bruce, Fear No Arts. Longtime viewers might recognize that name. Used to make videos on here. He's not been active in that sense too much recently, but he has been doing a Mixcloud show. The New Blues with Brother Bruce was kind enough to send me this t-shirt, which just arrived. I'll try and show that to you. Very cool. The New Blues with Brother Bruce. His Mixcloud show has a great knowledge and collection of jazz and blues. Be sure and check him out. I'll try and put a link down below. So on to the records. Recently, I've been revisiting some of the then current music I was listening to, circa about 2009 to 2012, as well as my usual forays into older music, into reggae. I was going through one of my periodic phases of keeping up with what was new in rock. One of the albums that caught my attention at that time was this critically acclaimed 2009 release by American indie rock group Dirty Projectors, led by lead singer, main songwriter David Longstreth. The lead single, Stillness is the Move, caught my attention. That peculiar title, the jerky yet hypnotic rhythm, and the lead vocals by female singers Amber Kaufman and Angel Diodorian. I liked that single, ended up getting it on CD. Might have listened to it a bit at that time, might have found it a bit weird. Probably wouldn't have gone too far out of my way to pick it up on vinyl. However, a recent flash sale at Vinyl Me Please had me looking at what they had available, and I ended up grabbing this 2020 expanded 2LP reissue for a good price. Had me digging deeper into the album, listening to it over and over, uncovering its many layers. This comes 2LP with the splatter effect, mimicking the cover color scheme. David Longstreth, one of these indie rock auteurs whose Ivy League scale of ambition, he was literally a student at Yale, and grandiose production method, putting in all these layers of Baroque strings, world beat textures, bits of funk, bits of stadium rock can be dizzying, sometimes deliberately confounding, but at the same time, there's this pop sensibility, this sense of melody and harmony and hooks going on. This was a breakthrough album for the group, holds a 5-star rating on allmusic.com. 2LP reissue. This has been expanded with several live versions of the songs in an unplugged acoustic setting, showcasing the intimate and emotional nature of the songs as Longstreth's more sensitive, fragile lead takes center stage, stripped of some of the production bombast and excess that he layers on the standard album cuts. There's also a few songs that appeared only on a 2009 EP. Ascending melody, almost doo-wop in the way the vocals are structured. Stillness is the Move, that single, still like it to this day, with the girls taking a lead vocal, as well as on Two Doves, one female singer each taking lead. Two Doves, more folky in that 2000s folk revivalism style of the time. Bits of plastic funk, stadium rock going on, these chiming sort of Afrobeat guitars. Just a heavily layered melange of textures, very ornate, but with the underlying sense of melody and accessibility, was a very successful album for the group. The back cover showing, or the inside cover here, showing Friedrich Nietzsche with David Longstreth, showcase maybe hinting at his level of ambition. Bit to Orca by Dirty Projectors.
Yeah.
categorize album right now, bringing in, as it does, elements of psychedelic rock, funk, jazz, even some experimental Moog synthesizer tracks, is William S. Fisher's Circles album, originally released in 1970 on Herbie Mann's Embryo Records imprint, a sublabel of Atlantic Records. This is a brand new reissue from Real Gone Music, which preserves the die-cut cover of the original, the Unipak design, and this time includes extensive liner notes and comes on what they call black ice colored vinyl, Embryo Records imprint, experimental label that Herbie Mann headed up. William S. Fisher was a composer, arranger, conductor, had cut his musical teeth playing saxophone in the 1950s with the likes of Cab Calloway and Ray Charles on some of his very earliest sessions for Atlantic Records, went on to work for Atlantic himself, as well as studying musical theory and composition at university, traveling to Vienna, Austria to learn about electronic music. He ended up as musical director for the acclaimed gritty soul masterpiece Outlaw by Gene McDaniels before getting the opportunity to head up sessions for his own project, which on which he used many of the same players on this album. Ron Carter on bass, of course, acclaimed jazz bassist, Hugh McCracken and Eric Weisberg on guitars, as well as Billy Cobham on drums. I actually have an original of this album, a promo copy I've owned for many years. This is another one from a big former DJ collection I was buying several records out of, a former radio station copy, radio station CKVN, and that is white label Embryo. Very hard to pigeonhole, some furious psych funk tracks, as on the opener, Patience is a Virtue, Saigon, again, amphetamine-fueled rock instrumental with some kind of gauzy Eastern melodies that kind of float through midway like clouds over rice fields, maybe as a helicopter is flying overhead. Of course, the Vietnam War in full swing at this time. Two completely computerized tracks in Electrics, and the final one, Capsule, with these kind of bleeps and pings, kind of simulating the sound of traveling through outer space. And then a couple of vocals by a friend of the group, Bill Robinson, otherwise unknown, does almost a gospel-styled civil rights-themed song, There's a Light That Shines, touching on themes of perseverance in the face of oppression. But psych funk with rock, with jazz, blues textures, many other elements going on, very complex, with something of an elliptical theme to the songs, to the progression of motifs, William S. Fisher's Circles LP. Quick run through now of some recent arrivals to the reggae collection that tie into previous videos I've done, but I didn't have them in time to show in those. A while back when singer Ernest Wilson passed away, I did a spotlight video on him, not kind of a household name, well-loved in the reggae world. He didn't release a lot of LPs, but plenty of singles. One of his signature songs that I believe I needle dropped in that video was I Know Myself, done for Channel One earlier this year. That was reissued by DKR Records out of New York, a 12-inch single, I Know Myself, backed with three different dub versions, some from Jamaica, some from the UK. Nice to have those on a nice nicely pressed 12-inch single, one of my all-time favorite songs from Channel One. Spring of this year brought the sad passings of two out of three members of the Mighty Diamonds, lead singer Tabby Diamond, due to a gunman's bullet. I've picked up a couple more Mighty Diamonds pieces in the time since then, a couple of their Channel One classics, Have Mercy, all these from the mid to late 70s, and also Back Way on the Impact label, Mighty Diamonds classics from the Channel One Rockers period. And in November of 2021, this reissue came out, the Mighty Diamonds Better Days. I hadn't picked this up at the time in time to show in the video tribute to them, but it's now in the collection. These are recordings done in London, backed by the Rough Cut Band, formed around Crucial Tony Phillips, who's also worked with Adrian Sherwood and On You Sound. Two songs on here, the title track Better Days and White Squall, appeared as singles around 1999, 2000. This finds a full LP of unreleased songs and dubs from the same sessions. It was put out late 2021 by Global Beats label. Great 1990s reggae sound, an updated sound, maybe not going to be to everybody's tastes. I personally love it. Was in the full swing of my first phase of reggae addiction in those years, so I have a lot of fondness from the sound of this period. And this finds the Mighty Diamonds, their harmonies, their roots and culture message unchanged from those 1970s Channel One days, just with an updated sound for the 90s. A while back, I did a spotlight on UK reggae band Aswad. A crucial dub album has now entered the collection thanks to a contact on Instagram. Be sure and check me out on there if you're not. A New Chapter of Dub is one I only ever had on CD. Spotted it once on vinyl at a record fair for a really good price. Had it in my hand, but foolishly put it back. I'd already spent too much and never seen it again. Always regretted that. So finally got the chance to make amends. I was even considering getting the recent Music on Vinyl reissue of this, which came out not too long ago. Nice to have an original classic early 80s UK dub album. This is deep, heavy, yet calm and meditational dub. Coming from about the same time, but completely different. I didn't do a video on these guys, at least not yet. I did make note of the passing of bass player Robbie Shakespeare last year, one I never had in the collection from the same seller that I got that Aswad dub album from, is Black Uhuru, The Dub Factor. Sly and Robbie, the bass and drum duo of Sly Dunbar and Robbie Shakespeare, were turning the reggae upside down with their highly technologically progressive brand of reggae at that time, using electronic drums, using synthesizers to create a sleek, almost funky sound to reggae, but still undeniably roots, and brought Black Uhuru much deserved international acclaim with that sound. This takes dub tracks or tracks from their albums Since Amelia and Red and runs them through the dub ringer. This is a Jamaican pressing on Island. Very good sound actually on this copy. Mixed by Paul Groucho Smichael. Could not be more different from the Aswad dub album, but both classics in their own right.
Tonight I'm gone.
couple of thrift finds the other day, first in a very long while, hopefully a sign of things to come. Maybe I'll sneak them into this video. I did manage to get out, have a look through the bins at one of my local stores, found this one, super clean copy, seen it around before, kind of been curious. Ima Sumac, Voice of the Ixtabe. This is 1950s Exotica. It's 70s Capitol pressing, compiling two EPs that she put out in 1950, Voice of the Ixtabe, her debut, and Inca Taqui from a couple of years later. She was basically a Peruvian folk singer. When she got discovered in America, they came up with kind of a mythology about her being an Incan princess, but basically Andean folk music set to exotica background, orchestral background, with arrangements by Les Baxter and her multi-octave singing. The average trained singer apparently can manage three octaves. She had four, some even say five. Her voice ranges from a guttural kind of growl or baritone right up to an operatic wail. Ima Sumac, Voice of the Ixtabe. Also, same time, I found Ella in London on the Pablo label. Ella Fitzgerald, jazz vocalist, 1974. Her only live recording done in London at Ronnie Scott's, somewhat of a relaxed, informal atmosphere. Starting to pick up these Pablo label jazz LPs. Not a hint of fusion, very traditional jazz for the early 1970s. Must have been very unfashionable, but always solid and classy productions. So that's it for today, guys. I want to thank everybody who tuned into my Poppy Family, Susan Jack's special. That one meant a lot to me. Also, the Lee Perry spotlights, those will continue. I'll probably have one of those up for you next. So until next time, thanks for watching and cheers, guys.